Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Between a Walk and a Dead Place by Leslie Budewitz, narrated by Dara Rosenberg. The Year of the Rabbit Parade Lineup. Wishes for good luck and fortune from the cast. At Seattle Spice, Pepper Reece, Mistress of Spice. Sandra Piniella, Assistant Manager and Mixmaster. Cayenne Cooper, Creative Cook and Problem Solver. Reedlock, Sales Clerk with a Secret Passion. Kristen Gardner, Pepper's BFF. Arf, an Airedale, the King of Terriers. The Flick Chicks. Pepper, Kristen. Laurel Holloran, Widowed Restaurateur and Houseboat Dweller. Seetha Sharma, Massage Therapist with a Mystery Man. Amy McGilvray, Owner of Rainy Day Vintage. Market Merchants, Residents and Friends. Nate Seward, The Fisherman. Chuck and Lena Reese, Pepper's Snowbird Parents. Roxanne Davidson, Assistant Curator of Small Weird Things. Aki Ono, The Eyes and Ears of Chinatown. Oliver Wu, a would-be hotelier with eyes for Seetha. Bobby and Abigail Wu, Sitting on History. The Law. Detective Michael Tracy, Major Crimes, Cookie Thief. Detective Cheryl Spencer, they've heard the jokes and they aren't laughing. Officer Tag Buhner, Pepper's former husband, on the bike patrol. Officer Paula Ono, walking the beat. 1. Contrary to its soft, vulnerable appearance and quiet personality, the rabbit is confident and strong, always moving toward its goal, regardless of criticism and obstacles. Though careful and attentive to detail, the rabbit often spices things up in surprising ways. The Year of the Rabbit, in Chinese astrology. "Try one of these, Pepper," my mother Lena said, pointing at the fat, transparent steam dumplings, her souvenir teacup tipping at a dangerous angle. "Shrimp, with ginger and scallions. Divine!" The short, dark-haired woman running the booth plucked a perfectly pleated morsel from a bamboo steamer and set it on my plate. Behind her, an elderly woman slid another steamer onto the table, lifted the lid, and released a warm, heavenly fragrance. If you've ever been to a cocktail party where you've had to juggle your wine glass, a too small napkin, and a plate of appetizers, all while avoiding elbows, trying to hear and be heard above the music, and nodding when introductions are made because you can't possibly free a hand, you've got an idea what the food walk during the Lunar New Year celebration in Seattle's Chinatown International District is like. What Seattleites call the CID, spelling out each letter. But for that dumpling, I'd brave it all. I stuck my bamboo chopsticks in my pocket to reduce the risk of putting out an eye, mine or a stranger's, and took the dumpling with my fingers. "Hargo," the woman said, "best in the city." A vinyl banner in the back of the booth, accented by a string of small red lanterns, repeated the claim, attributed to the Seattle Times food critic. Though I didn't agree with all the critic's reviews, her raves about my spice shop in Pike Place Market convinced me of her good taste. One bite, and I knew she'd nailed it.
"Total yum," I said.
She rewarded my praise with another morsel. I held up my phone. "Selfie with dumplings. Lean in." My friend Seetha, in her puffy white coat, bumped shoulders with my mother, while I, several inches taller with short spiky hair that exaggerates the effect, stood in back and snaked my arm between them to snap a couple of shots. Three dark heads, three happy faces. "I always thought dim sum meant dumplings," Seetha said, "but they've got all kinds of things." "Dim sum is a broad term." Our host wore a white chef's jacket, the name of a restaurant embroidered in red, in English and Chinese, over the left breast, and gestured to the array of dishes on the cloth-covered table with a graceful hand. "Dumplings, yes, but also rolls, small buns, cakes, and other dishes. And the tea. Always tea." I took a sip of mine. Green, scented with jasmine, perfect for the overcast January day. A good beginning for the Year of the Rabbit, though the new year didn't officially start until tomorrow, Saturday afternoon was the better choice for a food walk and art fair, followed by an evening parade. My spice shop sells a similar blend, not quite as smooth, and I wondered where they got theirs. We supply herbs and spices to hundreds of the city's restaurants and food producers, from a crepe cart to a fourth-generation butcher known for his sausage and salami to an internationally renowned chef's empire. But I'd only managed a small inroad in the CID. Hadn't tried very hard. Many of the restaurateurs in this part of the city, just south of Pioneer Square and the business district, have long relationships with other suppliers. They guard their sources like the bronze lions and dragons guard the gates of the Forbidden City. Traditionally served at brunch, but these days, our doyen of dumplings continued, the rest of her explanation lost in a cacophony of sound. Barely 10 feet from us, in front of the ceremonial gate that was as tall as some of the nearby buildings, a man dressed in red and black banged on a barrel-shaped drum. On either side of him, musicians clanged cymbals, small and large. A trio of four-legged lion dancers prowled the urban jungle, two in yellow and one in red. Everyone in the crowd packing the street stopped to watch. The man carrying the giant head of the red lion swung it from side to side, then up and down to the steady beat of the drum, while the man in back controlled the cape-like body. For a moment, I forgot the lions weren't real. Not that they were particularly realistic, not at all. Stylized, puppet-like, their red, yellow, and black eyes the size of saucers, the yellow-bearded tongues painted to match. Long, furry fringe hung from the cape and wound around the men's pant legs, swaying with their movements. Mesmerizing. The beat grew more pronounced. The man in the back end of the red lion scooped the front man up on his shoulders, holding tight as the mounted dancer swooped low, pretending to charge a small child who shrieked in delight. The dancer leapt back to the ground, and the men resumed their intricate footwork. Then a team of dancers swarmed around them, more modestly dressed in red and yellow pants and t-shirts. Each held a small lion head with a long tail that swept down his back. As the two-man teams had done, they swayed and swung, stomping their feet like the kings of the jungle whose spirits they were meant to invoke, lifting the heads high above their own and waving them in the air before pulling them back down over their faces. "Oliver!" Sitha cried, and though I couldn't imagine how he could hear her over the bang of the drum and the din of the crowd, the dancer nearest us stepped closer, lifted the head of his costume, and bowed to her, his long yellow and red tail sweeping the pavement. I caught the quickest glimpse of jet black hair and dark eyes before he clapped the lion mask back in place, and the troupe moved on. "That's him? That's your mystery man?" I said. "That's why you were so keen on coming." The flush on Sitha's brown cheeks answered for her. "The lions dance to bring good luck and fortune," the dim sum woman said, an impish smile on her face. Behind her, the old woman muttered something in Chinese, then bent and turned away. The street dancers were a preview to tonight's parade, though we didn't plan to stay that long. The festivities in the CID are the biggest and best attended in the city, fitting for the heart of Seattle's Asian community. But celebrations would be held all over town during the next 2 weeks. Even in Ballard, the historically Scandinavian neighborhood near Fisherman's Terminal. And it wasn't all furry frivolity. Art exhibits, cooking classes, and lectures on the history of Pan-Asian Seattle filled the calendar. Fundraisers abounded, from sequined galas to 5Ks. My former employee Matt and his girlfriend were taking part in tomorrow's rabbit run, raising money for a community health center, and they'd hit up my shop for a healthy pledge. Me? I was in it for the food and the friends, and the bright colors and sounds and energy that kept me from missing my guy, Nate Seward. Ha, as if anything could. But at least keeping busy kept me from obsessing over the danger he faced every day, fishing the icy waters of the North Pacific off Alaska. My mother handed Sitha and me small paper plates of treats nestled in red paper cups. "Ooh, I love sesame balls," I said, "and egg tarts." "I've got dessert for your dad if we can find him," she said, scanning the crowd.
There he is.
She nodded toward my father, Chuck Reece, on the far side of the street. As she says, a tall spouse is useful in a crowd, especially a man who likes to wander off by himself. I get both my height and my curiosity from him. I bit into a sesame ball, warm and crunchy on the outside, sweet and smooth inside, finished it off. Wrapped the rest in my napkin and tucked them in my tote bag for later. Teacups in hand, we wound our way through the throng to watch a well-organized group of children, mostly Asian but not all, in red pants and shirts demonstrate martial arts moves. My father, over 6 feet with a full head of dark hair despite being past 70, stood beside a woman who did not reach his shoulder. Her gray and black hair was streaked with the same regal purple as her puffy parka, and both matched her pronged metal cane.
Aki! My mother cried. Lena!
The two women embraced. And this must be Pepper. I haven't seen you since, well, whenever it was, you were shorter than I. Now even my granddaughter towers over me. I'd hit 5 feet in the fourth grade and reached my current 5'7" at 14. No wonder I didn't recognize Aki Ono, though I'd heard the name many times. My mother introduced Sitha, then explained, "We met Aki and Ernie ages ago when we were setting up the free meals kitchen at the cathedral. They'd created a similar program down here and were so helpful. That led to several joint projects." She put a hand on the older woman's arm. "We were so sorry to hear about Ernie and Tamisa's funeral. He was a wonderful man." Now I remembered. My parents moved to Costa Rica a few years ago, and my brother handles their finances. They'd asked him to make a contribution in Ernie Ono's memory last winter to an emergency housing fund for elders, and he'd mentioned it to me. "You've moved on," Aki said, enjoying life. "We're moving back now," my mother said. "Part-time. Snowbirds. House hunting, so if you hear of anything," Aki gestured toward the stage. "Good to see the younger generation continuing the traditions." We turned our attention back to the demonstration. Two girls, 14 or 15, dressed in white, red scarves at their throats, wielded swords with the confidence of a chef slicing a tomato. They lunged, pointed, parried, and poked. Terrific and a little terrifying. Though neither blade touched the other girl, it was not hard to imagine either of them lopping the head off an enemy in a moonlit alley or taking down a trio of attackers, like Tom Cruise's character in The Last Samurai. Aki's cane made small movements in her hand, as if it harbored a secret desire to be a fearsome sword, but had been cast a different fate, helping a little old lady make her way through the streets. I glanced at my watch, a pink Kate Spade splurge from a few years back. "We've got to run. Sitha and I are meeting Reed and his family in Maynard Alley to watch his sister's dance troupe. You two coming?" I asked my parents. "We'll stay here," my mother said, and looped her arm through Aki's. "Reconnect with our old friend." After a round of nice to meet yous and good to see yous, Sitha and I took off. I opened my mouth to quiz her about Oliver when a familiar figure whizzed by on a bicycle. Sitha saw him too.
"Was that Tag?"
"My ex-husband, a Seattle police officer on the bike patrol."
"Yep, picking up an extra shift, I imagine. The bikes make it easier to work the crowds when it's this congested."
Everywhere, the festivities continued. We passed a booth with the largest wok I'd ever seen, clouds of ginger-scented steam filling the air. At the next corner, a Filipino dance troupe performed. Barefooted, bare-chested men playing shells and marimbas. We passed food trucks and booths selling jewelry and art. Everywhere, the rabbit ruled. Rabbits flew on brightly colored flags. They perched on tables and filled window displays, and stuffed rabbits endured the sweaty clutches of small children. I knew where we needed to be, but the crowds and the street closures blocked our path. Reed Locke is a college student who's worked in the spice shop since high school, long before I bought it. His dad's acupuncture clinic is one of the few medical offices left in the market, and Reed grew up prowling the market's nooks and crannies. He works afternoons at our warehouse and production facility and weekends in the shop, which means I don't see him as much as I'd like. Business was slow this time of year, so I'd readily agreed when he asked for the afternoon off
to cheer his sister on. The Locke family is one of the oldest and largest Chinese families in the city, and his grandfather had long been a mainstay in the Locke Family Association, though family in that sense meant a cultural connection rather than blood ties, defined by a shared name and region of origin in China. "Let's go that way and work our way around," I pointed. But though I'm a Seattle native and make occasional deliveries in the neighborhood, the CID is a bit of a maze. Within minutes, we were standing at the entrance of a narrow alley, the 4- and 5-story buildings on either side plunging it deep into shade, though the sun wouldn't set for another hour. The CID and adjacent Pioneer Square were shaped by the Great Fire of 1889 and the regrades, a mind-boggling early 20th century engineering campaign that sheared off tops of hills and filled in low spots. In some blocks, streets were lowered, creating a new ground floor, while in others, streets were elevated. The resulting labyrinth led to the city's ever-popular underground tour, a mashup of fact and fiction. There were plenty of hills left, enough to make you wonder why the white settlers who came here in the 1850s ever imagined it a livable place. Some alleys had functioned like streets well into the 1960s. Thanks to a recent reclamation project in the two neighborhoods, Nord, Maynard, and Canton alleys bustled once again. But this alley had none of their charms. Dark, the brick cobble grease-stained garbage and recycling bins obstructing any traffic that might have dared enter. "Let's go back," Sita said and started to turn. I was about to join her when a flash of light caught my eye. Low, almost at ground level, on, off, on, off, and a muffled sound like a door clanging shut. I waited. But no more lights and no more sounds. A rat shot out from beneath a garbage bin. I stifled a shriek and quickly followed Sita to the sidewalk where the red lantern street lights were coming on. "Which way?" she asked. The crowded sidewalks and well-lit storefronts were a welcome relief. More red lanterns had been hung on wires crossing the street, bright and festive. "Now I know where we are. That tea shop is one of my customers," I pointed. We hadn't gone far when a door at the top of the short flight of steps burst open and a woman emerged. A woman I knew. "Roxanne?" I'd never seen her look anything but perfectly polished, whether she wore a stylish pantsuit, a summer sundress, or as now, jeans and a turtleneck, running shoes, no coat. She was breathless, her eyes unfocused, her thick brown hair falling out of its twist.
"Pepper, I'm so glad to see you. I don't know what to do."
"About what?"
"The body. I think I found a dead body."
2. The fortune cookie, now an after-dinner ritual in Chinese restaurants across the United States, originated as a Japanese treat brought by bakers who immigrated to the West Coast around the turn of the 20th century. In her panic, Roxanne had left her cell phone behind, so I called 911. Sita stayed outside to direct the first responders, while Roxanne dragged me inside. "What are you doing here?" I asked. "What is this place?" Retail shops, offices, and restaurants occupied the street level, but nothing about the exterior gave a clue to what went on up the steps.
"The Gold Rush Hotel," she said, as the wood-framed glass door closed behind us.
My eyes struggled to adjust to the dim light. I made out a few chairs in the compact lobby, heavy brocade curtains with velvet tie-backs at the windows, glass-front curios filled with old jars, wooden boxes, and figurines lined two walls. Above the stairway to the upper floors hung musical instruments, ready for a guest to take down and play. A dark red carpet runner on the steps. I could just make out the wood paneling of the front desk, partially screened like an old-time bank, separated from the lobby by a maroon velvet rope. I'd been transported to another era, or the set of a Bogart and Bacall movie. Roxanne led me to a door, partly open.
"The hotel occupies the central section of the block. The rooms are upstairs. It's been closed for decades, but the owner is considering some changes and asked me to catalog the furniture and artifacts. I was finishing up for the day and thought I'd grab some dinner and catch part of the parade when I noticed the basement door was open. It's never open." You went down there? You could have been in danger. I wasn't thinking about that. I had to make sure. You'll understand when you see. It's a treasure trove.
Like the Panama? I asked, fumbling on the wall for the light switch. The Panama Hotel, once working men's lodging and now a national historic site, where Japanese Americans sent to the camps left suitcases and trunks. Some reclaimed their items, but others never did. And the basement storeroom had been cataloged, studied, and preserved. A window on a shameful past. Then I remembered a more recent discovery, where renovation uncovered long-lost murals from an African-American jazz club that thrived during Prohibition.
Or the Louisa?
No, nothing like that. I found the switch. A brass button on a brass plate. Held my breath. I love old buildings, but antique electricity is a tad scary, and pushed it. An overhead bulb on the other side of the door flickered, then stayed on. They seriously need to update their electrical system, I said, or at least install decent light bulbs. Roxanne had draped her navy coat over a wooden armchair near the door, her black leather briefcase beside it. Clutching my phone in one hand and fumbling for the handrail with the other, I followed her down the narrow stairs. At the bottom, she led me through a small area lit by a single bulb. A few stray bricks lay on the floor, alongside a stack of old lumber. What is this place? Is it safe to be down here? The air was damp, filled with the odor of mold and mildew. A heavy wooden door, its brass hardware darkened with age and disuse, stood open a few inches. Roxanne wrapped her arms around herself, her eyes wide.
I can't go in there. The blood, everything, it's too horrible.
I pulled my gloves out of my coat pocket, drew them on, and took a deep breath. Pushed the door all the way open. Flicked my flashlight app and slowly scanned the room. No windows, an interior room. Images began to emerge from the darkness. Rough wood shelves, stacked with small wooden boxes. Cabinets reminiscent of the red lacquered apothecary in my shop. A large work table. An old-fashioned scale. A heavy weight in one pan, holding it permanently off balance. Not a storeroom, not like the Panama. The bottles and tins behind the glass doors spoke of another history, another era. A Chinese herbal medicine shop or clinic? I took a step forward, then another. My foot crunched on broken glass, and I aimed my light at the floor. A broken bottle, two bottles, three, four, a mortar used to grind medicinal herbs. I raised the light. Tins and porcelain jars had been opened, their lids tossed carelessly aside. Wooden drawers, labeled with Chinese characters, had been jerked out of their cabinets. Some emptied and dropped on the floor. The herbs inside scattered, as though a search had been interrupted. I panned the light slowly across the wreckage, gasped as it found the body, even though I'd known it was here somewhere. A man, wearing yellow pants, a red brick, an arm, a shoulder, a red and yellow shirt. A pool of blood spread from the man's skull, an open wound visible through his short dark hair. I could not see his face. And for a moment, I was grateful, not wanting to see the broken bones or lifeless eyes. The taste and smell of death nearly overwhelmed me as I made out the long red and yellow tail of a lion dancer. Something glinted. Though the man's neck was twisted, his head facing away, I saw a silver chain and hanging from it, a tiny silver pendant in the shape of a fortune cookie. Good luck and fortune, the dim sum seller had said of the lion dancers. Maybe so, but the charm hadn't worked for this one. Had Oliver, the dancer who'd flirted with Seetha, been wearing a pendant like this? I couldn't recall. Heavy footsteps thudded on the floor above us. I heard Roxanne scurry to the staircase. Down here in the basement, she called. I stood and surveyed the room. Broken glass aside, not much damage. An open door led to a small room, empty but for what looked like a doctor's exam table. Unpadded and even more uncomfortable than most. Despite my coat, a chill swept through me. Was the man on the floor the interrupted or the interrupter?
What had the searcher been hoping to find? We'd seen no signs of anyone upstairs, and Roxanne had been sure she was alone. The doors locked. Who knew about this place? Who had keys? Who was the lion dancer, and who had killed him? And where was the killer now? My questions would have to wait. First to arrive were two patrol officers, an average-sized white man and a small Asian woman. I watched as they took in the scene, their gazes pausing briefly on the damage. The man crouched and touched a blue latex-gloved hand to the dancer's neck. "I think we can call off the EMTs," he said, but it was too late. First one medic, then another came into view, lugging the boxes of gear I had seen far too often and much too recently. I flashed on the memory of watching them work on young Beth Yardley in my friend Vinny's wine shop 2 days after Thanksgiving. Nearly 2 months ago, but the memory still haunted me. As the EMTs sized up the situation, the woman officer gestured, and I followed her out of the old pharmacy. Roxanne was waiting at the foot of the stairs.
"Is he?"
"Yes, ma'am," the officer replied. "He is unfortunately deceased." Roxanne let out a sound, halfway between a choke and a gasp, and clutched her throat. She swallowed hard, pressing her lips together, then exhaled and raised her chin.
"They won't touch anything they don't have to, will they? That place is like a museum."
"No, ma'am," the officer said, then ushered us up to the hotel lobby where she took out a notebook and introduced herself. "We'll need you to stay for a bit," she told Roxanne after we'd answered her questions about who we were and why we were here. "Until we can confirm your story. You're sure neither of you recognize the victim?" We did not.
"The owner lives upstairs," Roxanne said. "I think he's at the festival. I'll call him."
She rummaged in her briefcase for her phone. I peered outside.
Where was Sita? "Did you see where my friend went? The woman who was waiting to direct you, about 5'3", straight dark hair, South Asian Indian, wearing a puffy white jacket. She knew one of the lion dancers, though I can't imagine it's him. There are dancers all over today."
"Sorry, ma'am, no one was waiting. The door was unlocked.
I have to find her. She doesn't know this area, and it's super busy today. And there might be a killer in the crowd."
Roxanne had finished her call and returned.
"But I don't want to leave you alone." "Don't worry about me," she said. "Come back when you find her."
I looked to the officer for confirmation, noticing the name tag on her uniform. She'd introduced herself earlier, but the name hadn't pierced my rattled brain.
"Oh no, are you related to Aki?"
The purple streak in the officer's hair was the same color as the older woman's.
"You're her granddaughter, aren't you? My parents are Chuck and Lena Reece, friends of hers from the old days. She's a pistol."
"That she is," Officer P for Paula Ono said. "Always with a cause. My role model." The patrol sergeant entered as I left. I knew him vaguely from when I'd been married to Tag. Outside, other officers had cleared and blocked off the area. Night had fallen. The temperature had dropped and it felt like rain. The mood had turned too. No sign of Sita. If I called or texted, could she hear the phone in all this chaos? People wandered by in pairs and clusters, many sipping from the souvenir teacups that came with our tickets to the food walk, unaware that a man had been killed behind these doors. A brick to the head. It had to be murdered, didn't it? Tea. Roxanne could use a good cup. Maybe I could snare some as I scouted for Sita. What if the dead lion dancer was Oliver? Maybe it wasn't. It had been no exaggeration to say lion dancers were everywhere. A pair were entertaining a cluster of children across the street right this minute. I scanned the crowd, expecting to spot my friend watching for me, but no. I ducked under the yellow tape and headed for the tea shop. Family-owned, like most restaurants in this area, with a long history that had almost ended when the pandemic started. When the income stopped, but the rent was still due. The owner's 40-ish son, Keith Chang, had come home and taken over, reopening with a new name and a new look, and a menu he called Modern Traditional. Basically, anything he wanted with an Asian flair. In our conversations, he'd made clear his intent to introduce a wide range of flavors. "The only spices my parents used were star anise and Sichuan pepper," he told me, and a bit of ginger. But we are turning over a new leaf. Not a new tea leaf, though. For that, he was keeping their longtime supplier. And no, he couldn't be prodded into sharing the name. I made my way through the throng to the Fortunate Son Cafe. The first time I'd been here, Keith had been deep cleaning the kitchen, and the smell of old grease had about knocked me over. Nate and I had come to the reopening, complete with a blessing dance. Soft light spilled out the windows. A high-top counter lined the front window where customers sat on tall Zen stools, sipping their drinks and chatting as the world went by. Keith had pulled down the cheap vinyl wallboard and scrubbed the old brick behind it, now hung with artwork, all eye-catching and all for sale. A mezzanine level offered additional seating. Light and airy, modern and semi-industrial, with more than a nod to the past. I stepped inside. There she was, sitting at one of the gleaming new wooden tables, her back to me, speaking earnestly to a man in yellow.
Sitha, what are you doing here? Why did you leave? I was worried sick.
Pepper, what happened? Are you okay? Where's Roxanne? Sitha stood as if for a hug, but stopped herself.
I came in here to get out of the cold. I was just about to text you. I couldn't believe I ran into Oliver.
Oliver? Ripples of shock, relief, and anger ran through me.
So it's not you?
Pepper, what? Sit. This is Oliver Wu. Sitha slid over and patted the vacant stool. It was still warm, and I was still half speechless, a rare affliction, as anyone who knows me can tell you.
Roxanne,
Oliver said, glancing between us. Poor man, lost in the volley of our conversation.
She did find a body, I said to Sitha, in the basement of the building where she's working. The police and EMTs are there now, but I don't think there's any hope.
You mean, he's dead? She asked. I nodded.
Pepper, Happy New Year!
Keith Chang stopped at our table, his short black hair almost as spiky as mine.
I'll bring another cup. What else can I get you? We've got ginger scones, red bean cookies, and green tea ice cream, all spiced to perfection, thanks to you. We're serving our classic green tea in our winter hibiscus blend.
Tea. The reason I'd come to the Fortunate Son. Could I get 2 large go cups of green tea right away? It's kind of an emergency.
Sure.
He beelined for the service counter. I turned back to Sitha and Oliver and, for the first time, noticed the giant black tote bag on the stool next to him, overflowing with bits of red and yellow fluff.
I thought the man in the basement might be you. He was dressed in yellow and wearing a lion dancer head like yours.
The basement? Where? He demanded.
Next door, the Gold Rush Hotel.
He blanched, pushed back his stool, rapidly thumbed his phone, scrolling for...
What? Here you go, Pepper.
Keith returned with 2 large white paper cups, lids in place. I started digging for my wallet when he stopped me.
No worries. Tea emergencies are on the house.
But before I could thank him, Oliver found what he wanted on his phone. Raised his head, eyes wide, neck rigid.
Roxanne texted me. I hired her. I own the Gold Rush.
3. Chaos never picks a good time. Anonymous, that wise old philosopher. By the time we got back to the Gold Rush, there was no question that it had become a crime scene. More lights, more patrol officers, more yellow tape. Sitha and I followed Oliver inside. A uniformed officer asked Oliver for his ID, then spoke into his radio. The small lobby was overrun, and Roxanne had taken refuge in a chair in the corner, next to the windows, with their view of the comings and goings in the street below.
Tea, I said, the oldest medicine known to man, or woman.
She took the cup and sniffed the steam.
Thank you, Pepper. I don't know what I'd do without you.
My usual wisecrack,
lie in the gutter and weep,
was completely inappropriate under the circumstances, and I resisted the urge to spit it out. Roxanne and I didn't know each other well enough for my sense of humor. She was my boyfriend Nate Seward's ex-wife's younger sister, if you follow all that. We'd met last summer when a stone-studded silver trowel set, a sheath holding a knife and chopsticks, dating from 18th century China,
became evidence in a murder in a vintage shop in the building where Sitha lives. Roxanne is an assistant curator at the Seattle Asian Art Museum, and Nate had sent me to her for help. Since then, we'd become friendly, if not quite friends. And she mattered to Nate. A lot. That meant she mattered to me.
"Where's Nate?" she said. "He didn't come with you to the festival?"
"Alaska, fishing." I took the chair next to her and popped the lid off my tea. Sitha and I came down for the food walk. We were going to meet Reed, who works for me, to watch... Oh, parsley poop. I thumbed Reed a quick text. "Sorry, got held up." Wrong words. I'd X'd it out. "Something came up. I'll explain tomorrow. Good luck to your sister." Although her performance was probably long over. Outside, the light was fading. The afternoon had plumb slipped away. A white medical examiner's van pulled up.
"I don't understand why you went downstairs," I told Roxanne, pent-up emotion spilling out. "You're lucky you didn't get hurt. You don't have any idea who that poor man is?" "No. Like I told the officer, I consult with private owners sometimes. Oliver hired me to catalog the artifacts in the building. But the real find is that pharmacy. I told him he needs to bring in an expert to evaluate it and help the family decide how to preserve it, but his parents..."
"Well, if it isn't our good friend, Miss Pepper Reece, why did it not occur to me when we got a call about a body in the basement of a rundown hotel in the International District that I would run into you?"
"Detective Tracy," I said, "I can explain." The detectives had just come up the basement stairs.
I'd encountered Tracy, a short black man, and his partner, a tall blonde woman, several times in recent years. They were good cops, even if they didn't always have much patience for me.
"I'm sure you can. Meanwhile, tell me who your friends are and what you're all doing here."
"Miss Sharma, we know," he said, glancing at Sitha, standing between Oliver and Officer Ono. I introduced Detectives Tracy and Spencer. Yes, they've heard the jokes, and no, they're not amused, to Oliver and Roxanne, who explained her project. The forensics team arrived, and Spencer took them downstairs.
"You own this building?"
Tracy said to Oliver, and I heard his skepticism. Oliver was around 35, his hair in a trendy cut. His bright yellow outfit, on the other hand, well, I suppose the King of the Jungle look is always in style, though I hadn't spent a lot of time in the CID. I did know that most of the property down here is owned by families, some by family associations who manage the group assets. The street-level businesses, like the tea house and the barbershop and grocery store I'd passed, were rentals, though the hotel itself didn't appear to have been active for decades. It was remarkably clean, though, and I detected a hint of incense. Wait, hadn't Roxanne said the owner lived upstairs? Did Oliver live here?
"Yes," Oliver said. "No, actually, well, it's in the family." "Your parents, grandparents, where are they?"
Tracy surveyed the room with his usual sharp eye, as if expecting the elder Woos to materialize out of the woodwork or the faded rugs.
"I'll call my parents," Oliver said, "but I'd like to know more first."
"Wouldn't we all?" Tracy said.
"Detective," Roxanne interjected, "can we talk about the artifacts in the basement? I'm very concerned."
"We'll get to that, Miss Davidson," Tracy said. "Meanwhile, I have a dead body to identify."
He held out his phone. There are times when the screen is more humane than the real thing. And asking someone to identify a dead man is one of those times. Oliver stared at the screen.
No.
"So he wasn't part of your dance troupe?" I asked.
"The lion dancers who were at the food walk earlier, where you saw Sitha and me?"
"No," he repeated. "It's the Lunar New Year. There are lion dancers all over the place."
As I'd seen myself. But if my doppelganger were killed in my building...
"So you don't have any idea what he was doing in your hotel, in that basement that Miss Davidson is so concerned about?" Tracy asked. "Who has keys, besides the two of you? Your parents and who else?"
"It's Dr. Davidson," Oliver said. "To the hotel..."
"No one. As you can see, we haven't rented rooms in decades. I moved in a few weeks ago. That's when I decided we needed a professional assessment. We, the family, were considering the options."
Officer Ono spoke up.
What can you tell us about the pharmacy? I've been around the CID most of my life, and I've never heard a word about it.
Tracy grunted. He grunts a lot, and it's rarely a pretty sound. Whether he was displeased by the young officer's interruption or the thought of a crime scene complicated by historical status, I couldn't guess. Oliver rubbed the back of his neck.
Not that I want you to take all day, Tracy said, dropping into a leather chair that groaned with his weight. But if you're going to, I might as well sit.
Oliver perched on the couch opposite him, forearms on his thighs, hands tightly clasped.
I've always loved the hotel, though I never spent much time here. It belonged to my grandfather on my dad's side. He died decades ago. The first floor businesses all have separate street front entrances.
A lock of hair fell over one eye and he flipped it out of the way.
When I moved in, what prompted that? Tracy asked.
I broke up with my girlfriend and needed a place.
Oliver shot Seetha a quick look.
But it was time.
How much did she know of all this? We see each other most Tuesday evenings at Flick Chicks, a group of five women who talk as much about our personal lives as about the movie of the week, but Seetha doesn't say a lot. She doesn't get much chance, chatty as the rest of us are. She had mentioned having lunch with a new employee at a downtown hotel where she sometimes works as a massage therapist, and her cheeks had gotten bright. But that was all she'd said. And it hadn't occurred to me until she recognized him during the lion dance that she, not by any means a foodie, had harbored an ulterior motive for joining my mother and me on the Lunar New Year food walk. I sipped my tea and Oliver continued.
The Changs were redoing their tea room and ran into trouble with the plumbing. The access is through our basement, and when I took the plumber downstairs,
Tracy made a twirling motion with one finger, telling him to speed it up.
Turns out a couple of old doors had been blocked by false walls. One led to the passage with the plumbing access and the other to the pharmacy, clinic, herb shop, whatever you want to call it.
That explained the piles of construction debris.
When were these false walls put up? Tracy said.
No idea. I'd already hired Roxanne to inventory all this stuff.
He gestured toward the lobby cabinets.
And the things in the rooms upstairs, so I asked her to take a look. That's all I know about it.
How had the lion dancer gotten into the hotel? I was sure he'd been searching for something. Had the killer found it? Or was it still downstairs, hidden by the mystery of time? After the ME's crew carried out the body, the crime scene detective came up to brief Tracy. Spencer was still in the basement. In Seattle, crime scene investigations are conducted by officers, not lay technicians. They focus on the physical evidence, freeing the major crimes detectives like Spencer and Tracy to focus on the victim and witnesses. The CSI detective explained their procedure. First, a structural engineer would be called to ensure short-term safety. Then they'd photograph the scene and use 3D scanners before evidentiary items were collected, so someone who hadn't been at the scene could see it in all its detail. It's old. It's been closed off, I said. How can you tell what's evidence and what isn't?
Experience and professional judgment,
the detective answered.
We use alternate light sources to identify stains and pick out hairs and fibers. Putting evidence together to help solve a major crime is frankly one of the coolest things in the world.
It's not like on TV, Tracy said, but it is pretty impressive.
Roxanne seemed mollified, at least for now. Oliver's parents hadn't arrived yet. Detective, I said to Tracy. The victim was wearing a silver pendant. My fingers went to my throat.
Shape of a fortune cookie. I saw it. Any luck, Emmy's office will find his name engraved on it, but I'm not holding my breath.
They hadn't found a wallet or other ID then. John Doe, Lion Dancer. After making sure she had our contact information, Officer Ono escorted Seetha, Roxanne, and me to the door.
I'll tell my grandmother I met you, the officer said. She'll be pleased, despite the circumstances.
Outside, the crowd had thinned. I was starving. The Hagau, memorable as they were, had been hours ago. Back we went to the Fortunate Son, where the after-parade crowd nursed cups of tea, sake, and other comforts. We found a table upstairs and ordered the Lunar Special, a cabbage pancake with shrimp and a variety of sauces, size to share, and a red bean cookie sampler.
Roxanne protested that she was too upset to eat, but when the plates came, she dove in.
Me? I am rarely too upset to eat.
Food is my comfort and joy, as well as my profession, and I was thrilled to see the cafe so busy on this special night. People in food service are the hardest working people I know, from the produce sellers to the dishwashers to the line cooks. They do the work because they love food and feeding people, even though the job is hard, the hours long, the pay pitiful, and the people, well, people are difficult sometimes.
I'm not sure the police understand how important that pharmacy is, Roxanne said, historically and culturally.
What do you know about it? I asked. No surprise that I didn't know the story, but neither did Paula Ono, with her deep roots in the CID. Though her family was Japanese, but history is part of the air down here.
Almost nothing, Roxanne said. As Oliver said, it just came to light.
Pepper can help, Sita said. She's great at asking questions and digging up the past.
Roxanne turned to me.
Would you? Please? I don't know. I've got a full plate.
I forestalled entreaties by excusing myself and headed for the restroom. Keith might know a few things about the Gold Rush, the pharmacy, and the Wu family, but he was far too busy for a pop quiz. On the narrow stairs to the basement, I stopped on the landing to let two women by, going up. The elderly woman in front used a cane, a burgundy version of Akiono's purple stick. Her slow progress made slower by her pauses to converse with the younger woman behind her.
Xian Mo,
the older woman said.
She and Mo, to my ears, not used to an inflicted language.
Seriously, Mom, death by possession, wandering ghosts, where do you get these ideas?
Mom moved up one step, talking over her shoulder. That building knows. The Wus have not done right by it. They have dishonored the past.
She was talking about the body in the Gold Rush. I touched the brick wall next to me, the hotel basement on the other side.
I know,
she continued, and let go of the iron handrail long enough to tap her skull with one bony finger.
The spirits will get their revenge.
The daughter gave me a what can you do look. I smiled in sympathy, though my bladder wasn't so understanding, and the moment they passed, I dashed down the last few steps. Oliver had said the Changs needed to upgrade the plumbing. Must have been for the kitchen, because the remodel had not touched the tiny restroom. Both sink and toilet were rust-stained, and the thick green paint on the walls was peeling in places, revealing shades of red and gold beneath. The effect was not unpleasant, stains aside. Back when faux finishes were the rage in interior design, trendsetters had paid good money for walls like this. How had word spread so quickly? And what did the old lady mean when she said the Wus had dishonored the past? Truth is, every community has its secrets, known only to those on the inside. Which I was not, but I was intrigued. Enough to help Roxanne? Maybe. If I hoped to learn more about the secrets of the Gold Rush, I would have to hope fortune shone on me. 4. Researchers have found that most people share similar preferences when it comes to smell, despite differing backgrounds and cultures, and consider vanilla the most pleasant aroma on the planet. Stinky feet come in last. The Uber dropped Roxanne and me outside the front door of my loft on Western, the street below Pike Place Market, then sped off to deliver Sita to her apartment in Eastlake. When we left the CID, Roxanne had been so rattled that I'd invited her to spend the night at my place. I showed her the bathroom and the mezzanine that serves as my spare bedroom, then grabbed Arf's leash and took him outside. While Arf, a 5-year-old Airedale, watered the nearest tree, I checked my texts. One from Sandra, my assistant manager, saying the afternoon had been slow, but they'd wrapped up with a big sale, and I'd be pleased when I saw the day's take. I replied with a series of hearts and happy emojis. Then Reed, saying, no problem, his sister had done great, video attached. I thanked him, promising to watch. Finally, my mother, saying they'd seen a cluster of police cars when they left the CID and hoped nothing had happened.
If you see a cluster of police cars, chances are something happened. But I wasn't going to tell her tonight. Instead, I raved about the food and the martial arts demos and how good it was to see Akiono again. I did not mention meeting her granddaughter. I tucked the phone away as we got moving. Turned out I needed the walk as badly as Arf did. We strolled down to the waterfront, the bracing air coming off Elliott Bay strong enough to clear my head after the terrible discovery in the gold rush. Poor Roxanne. Most people never encounter violent death up close and personal. But what if something else was going on, something she hadn't mentioned? She'd been slow to answer questions about the pharmacy and the victim, and I wondered if she recognized him but kept her mouth shut. Certainly Oliver Wu had given me that impression. Tracy would have picked up on it. At times, I swear the man is a mind reader. Other times, he confuses tact with tactical training, swinging smart remarks like a nightstick. Spencer kept him in check most of the time, but she'd been downstairs with the forensics team when Tracy quizzed Oliver. How much to tell Nate? After the walk, I'd tell him how his former sister-in-law had found a body and ended up sleeping in my loft. I'd managed to stay friends with.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.